here comes the for loop, spelled F-O-R, not like the number F-O-U-R, or in golf, for, F-O-R-E. The for loop is a counting loop. It's used to count things. So if you want to count stuff, use the for loop. The for loop has three parts: initialization, the test to see if we want to loop again, and the increment. The for loop is just a fancy while loop. It has the initialization, the test, and the increment all put together in one line. Here is a comparison between the for loop and the while loop. Both loops use the variable I to increment through the loop. The for loop starts off and says for, open parentheses. Here's our initialization, I equals 1, semicolon, that's a statement. Then we have the test, I is less than or equal to a 10, semicolon, that's our test statement. And then there's the increment, I plus plus, and notice there's no semicolon there, close parentheses. This example shows a block of code attached to the for statement. All it does, it says cout, I, and then endl, so it's going to print 10 lines, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. The while loop does the exact same thing. We start off with a variable called I. This time we actually have to initialize I to a 1 before we go into the while. So the initialization starts before we even enter the loop. The while then does the test and it says I less than or equal to a 10. So as long as that's true, we keep looping through the while. We have a block of code hooked up to the while loop. Cout, I, endl, and then we have the increment inside the while loop, right there at the bottom. Oh, it's very typical to put our increment as the last thing. We make sure we do everything, and then we increment I and see if we need to go through the loop again. If you compare the for loop and the while loop, notice where the increment is in the while loop, right at the bottom. The same thing occurs with the for loop. The last thing that happens in the for loop is I is increment. In this example, I'm showing a block of code attached to the for statement. Since there is only one line of code, the curly braces are not needed, although some companies will insist that you always use the curly braces regardless of whether you have one line or multiple lines of code attached to the for statement. Watch out for those semicolons. We need the semicolon after the initialization statement. We need the semicolon after the test. And no semicolon after the increment, and especially no semicolon at the end of the line. Let's take a closer look at what happens with the semicolon at the end of the line. The statement that's hooked up to the for is really just a continuation of the for statement. In the second example, it shows one long statement, it has the for, and the attached statement, which is really still part of the for statement, and it's the semicolon at the end of the line in both cases that really ends the for statement. In the case where you have a block of code attached to the for statement, then it's the block of code that ends the for statement. Now let's look at this one. Bad semicolon. Bad, bad semicolon. There's a semicolon at the end of the for statement on the second example. What happens is there's still a statement attached to the for statement, but it's an empty statement. Now, in this example, the for statement still executes 10 times, and it executes that empty statement 10 times. Then it executes the cout statement only once. Instead of saying 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, it does the loop 10 times and doesn't do anything. At the end of the loop, I is an 11, then it says 11, but it never did the 1 through 10. This is even worse with the while statement. If I have a semicolon at the end of the line with the while, there's still that empty statement. This example shows I equals 1. While I is less than or equal to a 10, it is less than or equal to a 10. It executes the dummy statement, and it never goes and increments I, so it's stuck there forever saying, while I is less than or equal to a 10, while I is less than or equal to a 10, it's still a 1, while I is less than or equal to a 10, and it's still a 1. It's going to do that forever. This is called an infinite loop. I still remember the time it happened to me. Back in the olden days where we used punch cards for our programming, we had to walk to and from the computer center in the snow, barefoot, both ways. I did this loop, and it was an infinite loop, and I didn't realize it. And it was on a machine that cost several $1,000,000, and it worked out to about $500 an hour. 15 minutes later, the computer operator called me up and said, "Dan, how long is your program supposed to run?" I says, "Oh, probably a quarter of a second." He says, "Well, it's been running continuously for 15 minutes. Do you want me to kill it?" I said, "Oh, yes, please." The next day, I got called into my boss's office, and he said, "Dan, you wrote a program that used up 15 minutes of computer time that worked out $125. Well, I was really paid well back then as a professional, $15 an hour, but it still worked out to about one full day's worth of pay, not counting any deductions. So I was very careful to never do that again. I guess we're kind of lucky, because if you're working on a PC or a Mac, well, you just wasted a little bit of your time. All you had to do is kill the program if it didn't come up and start running right away like you expected. But how about, I think one time it happened to AT&T. Somebody had a bad semicolon, and it completely shut down AT&T long distance. MCI was the other carrier at the time. They said, "Hey everybody, AT&T went down. We're still up and running. We're up and running. Yay, MCI." Well, about 6 months later, same thing happened to them. And AT&T said, "Ha ha ha, now we're the ones who are running, and you're not. Boo to you." So be careful for your infinite loop possibilities. That's all for now. Have a wonderful day. And remember, 4 is a good counting loop, but it's just a fancy while loop. Bye-bye.